Hey crazies, have you ever wondered why we have size? No, I mean really thought about it. Why do we take up space? Asking this calls into question the very nature of space itself. It might seem like a strange question, so let's take this slowly, one step at a time. In a previous video, we said this about a tennis ball. This ball is made of a rubber shell covered in a nylon felt surrounding a pocket of air. Each of those materials is made of molecules, which are made of atoms, which are made of subatomic particles, some of which are made of even smaller particles. On a basic level, we are made of the same stuff as that tennis ball. Everything is. Every atom on the periodic table is made of protons, neutrons, and electrons. Those protons and neutrons are made of the same two types of quarks. But how big are quarks and electrons? There are actually a few different ways to answer that. It depends on what kind of quantum physicist you are. If you're extremely cautious, you might remember what I said in the Planck video. At 10 to the negative 18 meters, we reach the smallest distance we've ever measured at the making of this video. At which point you'd say,
all we really know is that quarks and electrons are at most 10 to the negative 18 meters across.
That isn't any fun though. So if you're like me and you don't want to sit on the metaphorical fence, there are two ways you can go from here. Option one, you could say it depends on how it's interacting with other particles. Say an electron is in a particular energy state, like 3s. It could be anywhere that's orange. Therefore, it is everywhere that's orange. Therefore, that's how big it is, which is effectively the size of the entire atom. Even if you use a photon to measure a more specific position for the electron, you'll still have an uncertainty about it. Whatever that uncertainty is, that's how big the electron is. But that's not very satisfying, nor is it particularly useful. Option two. Richard Feynman once said, the electron is either here, or there, or somewhere else. But wherever it is a point charge. What's that mean? He's saying particles don't have size. Here's the basic idea. This picture doesn't actually show the electron, only the probability of where it might be. This spot is dimmer, so it has a lower chance of being here. That spot is brighter, so it has a higher chance of being there. But wherever it happens to be, regardless of what uncertainty your measurement might have, it is only a single point. It has no size. So how can a bunch of things that don't have size come together to make something that does have size? It's the space between particles that gives everything size. A proton has size because its quarks are separated by some distance. An atom has size because of the space between electrons in the nucleus. Thinking like this still has its problems, though. Problem number one. It gives you the impression that somehow space is empty when it's actually very full. The space between quarks is full of gluons binding those quarks together, giving all atoms 99% of their mass through E equals mc squared, and causing unstable quarks to pop in and out of existence. But gluons don't have any size either, so this doesn't solve our problem. It just makes the picture more complicated, so we're not going there. Problem two. The definition of a point leads to some paradoxes. A single point has no size and zero dimensions. It has no length, no width, no height, no surface area, and no volume. It just is. A line is a collection of points. It has one dimension, a length, but it has no thickness. A bunch of points make a line, and a bunch of lines make an area, and a bunch of areas make a volume, or what you might call a space. Unfortunately, this just brings us back to our previous question. So how can a bunch of things that don't have size come together to make something that does have size? Well, there are only a few ways we can reconcile this. Solution one, am I making too many lists?
Never.
Solution one, maybe something weird happens because space is infinitely divisible. For any two different points on this line, there is an infinite number of points between them. This level of infinity, or cardinality, is labeled with a fraktur script C for continuum. So somehow we gain additional dimensions by having an infinite number of lower dimensional objects. But you know me, I'm always a little hesitant to apply infinities to the real universe. Solution two. Maybe points have to be separated by some unoccupiable distance. Yeah, I said unoccupiable. I don't care if it's not an official word, as long as it takes the idea out of my brain and puts it into yours. Anyway, I'm just saying that an electron could exist here, here, or here, but nowhere in between. That might seem a little weird, but it fits right into the status quo of quantum physics. Solution three. Maybe points actually have size. Maybe they're not zero-dimensional. If they make up a three-dimensional space, maybe they also have to be three-dimensional. But that brings up a bunch of other questions. What shape are they? If points are boxy, what are the length, width, and height? If points are round, what is their diameter? How do they fit together? Are they all the same? It's madness! Physicists are currently working hard on it, but it might take a while. What do you think the solution is? Infinities? Mandatory separations? Points with size? Or something else? Please share in the comments. Thanks for liking and sharing this video. Subscribe if you'd like to keep up with us. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. In the last video, we discussed why humans are the size they are. Comment response time! Spaskiba was wondering if octopus arms behaving independently of the central brain was anything like having your left and right brain separated. When human brain hemispheres get separated, they do seem to behave independently in some ways. I'll put some links in the doobly-doo about it. But even then, there still does seem to be a single cohesive consciousness. You're still you. Mostly. You just lost the ability to do things, like properly identify objects. An octopus brain is different because it benefits from the independence, whereas you are hindered by it. P.S. I hope I didn't come across harsh correcting you about squids versus octopuses. I wanted to save your question for comment responses, but also wanted to make sure you didn't make the mistake with someone less forgiving before I had a chance to make this video. David21686 asks why we couldn't just be 10 times taller and change our body structure so we could handle it. Geronimo Cornplanter responded with an answer I couldn't have said any better. We could be 10 times taller, but then we wouldn't be human. This body structure is part of what defines our species. Elliot Gray can't get the Attack on Titan theme out of his head. You're not alone, Elliot. Tetracarbon seems to have accidentally started a conversation about the metric system, math bases, and counting. I got involved and mentioned that technically we already count to 12. If we really only counted to 10, then instead of saying 11 and 12, we'd say 1 teen and 2 teen. Or as Chuck32 would say, first teen and second teen. Which, you know, I think those actually sound better. If you're into that sort of thing, you should check it out. And a nod to Pavic, your consistent encouragement does not go unnoticed. Just wanted you to know. Anyway, thanks for watching. See you next time.